There are too few beacon lights in the Congress of the United States. But of the few, one of the brightest is our next speaker. The Honorable John R. Rarick, representative from Louisiana's 6th District. A native of Indiana, Congressman Rarick graduated from Tulane University Law School with a Juris Doctorate degree in law in 1949. He was admitted to the Louisiana Bar that same year. He served as district judge in Louisiana for 5 years and was elected to the Congress in 1966. He has continued to be reelected by his constituents to serve 3 additional terms. During World War II, he served as an infantryman in the United States Army and was decorated with the Bronze Star and the Purple Heart. He was captured in the Battle of the Bulge and incarcerated by the Germans. After a 4-month prison term, John Rarick escaped his captors and in 13 days of struggle made his way back to American lines. Congressman Rarick has received innumerable citations from patriotic organizations across the country. And among them are the number one representative in the United States Congress by the National Economic Council and the Distinguished Service Award from the Americans for Constitutional Action. He is married and the father of 3 children. He is sponsor of a House resolution presently before the House Foreign Relations Committee to get the United States out of the United Nations. Speaking on the subject of finance of the United Nations, it is an honor for me to introduce the Honorable John R. Rarick of Louisiana. Congressman Rarick.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, my fellow countrymen, those who with me would rather be free and alive than a red and dead. Greetings. Financing the operations of the United Nations is based upon a simple, easily understood principle. The Robin Hood theory of international finance: rob the rich to give to the poor. And the U.S. taxpayer has been the prime victim of this brand of international hijacking from the U.N. for now over 26 years. The figures I'll quote come directly from the State Department through the Library of Congress. But they weren't easy to get. The State Department is nervous about publishing an accurate accounting of the hidden U.N. monies received from you citizens. Let's probe a little bit. Let's take a closer look at the facts and the figures behind this great U.N. robbery of Americans. Over the years, the U.S. Congress has given the U.N. crowd whatever it's asked for, often upwards to 40% of the U.N.'s operating budget. So last year, when Congress reduced the assessed contributions made to the U.N.'s regular budget to 25%, cries of anguish ran out. Headlines rocked the world with dire predictions of U.N. bankruptcy and the perilous financial future the U.N. must surely face. The U.N. propagandists trembled in print with fear that this reduction could signal a congressional slash of all U.S. contributions to that world organization. Congress, in an election year, looked good for its fiscal responsibility and slowing down reckless spending. Conservatives breathed a sigh of relief. Maybe now the U.S. government was coming to its senses. Let's not kid ourselves. After all the hand-wringing and head-shaking of the U.N. money lobbyists from the State Department was over, and the U.N. crowd went back to New York City with the money from you that Congress had given them, the United Nations had ripped off more money from the U.S. taxpayers than ever before. In the 26 years we've been a member of that Global Village Country Club, our dues have cost the American taxpayers over $4,700,000,000. $4.7 billion of American taxpayers' dollars. And that doesn't include the $65 million luxury clubhouse we built for them in New York City. When the American people, thanks to the CFR, began bankrolling the UN in 1946, Congress signed a blank check, payable on demand, that, quote, authorized to be appropriated annually to the Department of State out of the Treasury such sums as may be necessary for the payment by the U.S. of its share of the expenses to the United Nations as apportioned by the General Assembly of the United Nations. And they know all about apportionment. Earl Warren, who wrote the decision, is now the head of the United Nations Association. What this U.S. public law says is very simple. The U.N. tells us how much they want. They fix our tax, and we give it to them. The financial charges to the U.N. members are based upon a member's capacity to pay as determined by national income estimates, also known in some newspapers as the gross national product. If the phrase capacity to pay sounds familiar, it should. It comes from the Fabian Socialist Communist principle. From each, according to his ability, to each, according to his need. The UN founding fathers lifted this directly from that wonderful humanitarian document, the Constitution of the USSR. Our share of the financial burden of the UN has always topped the list of assessments. Until Congress cut it last year, our assessment was almost one-third of the budget. Our closest competitor for the honor of contributing the most money to the UN General Assembly budget is the Soviet Union. Their share is a staggering 14%. But that really doesn't mean much since they don't pay their bills anyway. The Russians are almost $90 million in back dues alone. In fact, as of January, 87 of the 132 members were almost $168 million in arrears on contributions on three major accounts. So the crowd that runs the UN calls the shots and rams its political ideology through the General Assembly, and they're doing it with our money. We pay the bills, and they have the votes. During calendar year 1972, the total amount assessed against the U.S. was $130,522,000. The pro-UN lobby points out that this amount is minimal when compared to the money we spend on national defense or on domestic programs. But what these same people fail to mention is that our voluntary contributions to special programs of the United Nations greatly exceed the total UN regular budget. It's the voluntary contributions, which you seldom hear of, that account for more and more of your tax money being funneled into the United Nations conspiracy. The same blank check legislation which funds the regular budget of the UN gives our president authority to make contributions on a grant basis to numerous international organizations and programs. Only one of these special UN giveaway accounts has any legal ceiling. There is no legislative limitation on voluntary contributions to special programs. This loophole, which takes the watchdog eye of Congress off the UN funds, is the dodge the State Department has used to siphon tax money out of the Treasury into the UN. In calendar year 72, $351,445,000 of your money was drained out of our country in this manner. Our voluntary contributions to special projects ran as high as 78% of one entire project, with most being well above the 1-4 ceiling placed on the regular budget. That UN bunch knew it had nothing to fear when Congress reduced funds in the regular budget. They had the protection of the administration and the often overlooked Lodge Commission recommendation, which quotes, each reduction in the U.S. share of the regular budget must be clearly marked by at least a corresponding increase in U.S. contributions to one or more of the voluntary budgets or funds in the U.N. system, unquote. That's the kind of a guarantee the U.N. enjoys, thanks to the White House. I call it the Tar Baby Principle of U.N. finance. You remember the story of Brer Robin's bout with the Tar Baby? Every time he'd take a swing at the sticky little devil, he'd end up stuck worse than before. And that's the position Congress is in. When U.N. funds to the General Assembly budget are cut off, the White House adds those funds back to another U.N. program. That's what they mean by voluntary. It's a vicious circle, and you, the American public, continues to lose. The internationalists hold the purse strings, though Congress killed the foreign aid bill appropriation last year. It has now passed the emergency, further continuing appropriations of 1973. The annual funding level for fiscal 73 amounts to more than $3.6 billion, nearly $500 million above the 1972 level. So the voluntary funding of the U.N. programs continues higher than before. But in the continuing appropriations bill, you won't find one single mention of the U.N. The money they get is covered up, hidden away in the astronomical figures of the great foreign aid steal. All but 121 of the 132 members of the U.N. have received U.S. foreign aid since the end of World War II, a total that reached $161 billion in 1971, over one-third of our national net. So not only do we pay the U.N. bills, we also give the other members dues indirectly through foreign aid. And the Tar Baby Syndrome continues. The State Department told Congress that what we gotten for our money when they justified a U.N. request before the Appropriations Committee last year. The U.N., they tell us, provides a public forum for clarifying to a wide audience our position on issues of vital concern to us and for enlisting support to the international action on matters of prime concern. So, for the $481,967,000 the taxpayers shelled out in 72 the U.N., we bought a soapbox on which to stand and clarify our position to the world. We paid almost $500 million last year for a soapbox, and a mighty ineffective one at that. Just asked our friends in Taiwan. Instead of our excessive admission fee giving us a vehicle to sell American goals and American solutions to the world, we paid for a podium for the U.N. red and socialist members to sell their goals and ideas to America.
Thank you, Congressman Rarick. We had 100 John Rarick's in the Congress, we'd be out of the United Nations at 9 o'clock Monday morning.